Illinois, being with family, and do have a message for you. And so I want you to go with me to Proverbs chapter 23. Let's get right into the Word. God's amazing. I'm telling you what, the Lord spoke to me about 2017, and He said, this was the Word that God had given me. He said, for those that have hung on. Now, I don't know about you, but 2016 was hell. Now, I don't know another way to say it. It was a good year. Don't misunderstand me. I've never seen the righteous forsaken or a seed begging bread, but I don't remember a year that I was more glad was over than last year. And He said, for those of you who have held on, 2017 will be a breakout year. And I'm looking at you. You've held on. And I'm telling you what, hang on, because 2017, it has already started out for us totally different. I was telling them this morning, I told Pastor Bob and Debbie this weekend, that the doors that God has opened to us, I have no other explanation, but God's just amazing. I have never asked to preach anywhere. I've never contacted pastors. I've never sent out letters trying to get preaching engagements. And the doors that He's opening is just phenomenal. Through Matt, I mean, we've been to Texas twice, we've been to Brussels. April 3rd, we leave for Peru with Pastor Callahan. The middle of April on the 19th, we go to Brussels. In May, we go back to Brazil. And all of that travel, I said this morning, I don't know if you realize it or not, but they don't let preachers fly for free. They don't even give us a discount, believe it or not. And all of that travel is totally paid for. And that's how we have started out 2017. I like that. And we've had, I mean, people just walk out and say, I'm just doing what God's told me to do. And do it. Partners that have partnered with us, believe in what we're doing. I don't solicit anything. If you ever get a letter from me that asks for money, you tear it up, because I don't ever do that. But I do send a letter out every month, just telling you what's going on and sharing word with you, whatever God has laid on my heart for that month. If I can't get to step on your toes, I can send you a letter. You can decide whether to read it or not. But if you'd like to receive that, if you'll give your information to Elizabeth, and we'll get you on that list. Like I said, don't ask for money. If you ever get a letter from me asking for money, it ain't from me. I don't do that. God takes care of Pastor Jim and Elizabeth, and He does an excellent job. What? Oh. You learn to watch your wife while you preach, don't you? She goes like this. Many years ago, we were out in Kansas and I was preaching. And listen, guys, if you're smart, you watch your wife while you preach, because she'll tell you things nobody else will. You know, the congregation will watch you with, you know, your zipper's undone, and they ain't going to say nothing, but your wife will go, hey. And so I'm preaching out in Kansas, and she's sitting on the front row like this, and I look over, and that's back when I had long hair. My hair was about down the middle of my back, and she was like this. And so I'm thinking, my hair must be sticking out really bad. So I just kind of did like that and went on preaching. And a couple minutes later, she did it again. I thought, man, this must be really bad. So I kind of even mess with my hair, and I keep preaching, and she does it again. And finally, I stopped, and I said, what? And she goes, what are you talking about? I said, you keep going like this? She goes, I had an itch. See, because, beloved, there's a statement from a book. I've recommended it many, many times. It's a secular book. It's called Extreme Ownership. It's probably the best leadership book I've ever read. It's written by Navy SEALs. It's a really easy read. They actually talk about what they've done in Iraq, on the missions they went out on, what they learned from them, what they did right, what they did wrong. And then they apply it to business. And so I highly recommend it, because there's a quote from that book that has made such an impression on my life. They said, whatever you tolerate will become the new standard. I want you to hear that, because that is so true. Whatever you will tolerate in your life will become the new standard. And what the devil wants you to do is to get that mentality in you that this is how it's always going to be. And if he can get that mentality in you that this is how it's always going to be, you don't expect anything to ever change. And that's why he'll do that. You know, maybe for a while you'll have extreme pain in an area of your body, and you'll believe God somewhat to get the pain relieved, but then the expectation is, well, I'm probably always going to have to live with this. And that, what you have tolerated, becomes the new standard in your life. And we start making provision for what the problem is. We start making provision for what the lack is. And God has never designed us to live that way. We are the only one of his creation that doesn't adapt to their surroundings. You stop and think about it. We don't adapt to our surroundings. If it gets cold outside, we go to the thermostat and we heat it up. We don't grow fur. I mean, I know I've said that many times here before, but beloved, all the rest of God's creation, they are designed to adapt to what's going on around them. We're not adapt that way. We're not to adapt. We're to change our circumstances. And what the, I'm telling you what, beloved, the devil hates the thought of the righteous having money. Because with money, we are extremely dangerous. That's what we've got to get a hold of. So we have to know that it's God's will for us to prosper. Well, Pastor, we know that. No. It has to become first nature to us that anything that's contrary to that, we will not put up with it in our lives. Here's what happens is if finances begin to shrink, we start thinking we got to start cutting back. Is that normal? And have you noticed the more, now I'm not talking about being extravagant when you can't afford to. But what I'm talking about, when the pressure comes and you think we need to cut out this, we need to cut out that, we need to cut out this, have you noticed when you get that mentality, your finances continue to shrink? You can never cut enough. And the devil keeps trying to push us into this box and push us into this box. And look, we serve a God who's more than enough. We serve a God who created the heavens and the earth. He's so wealthy, he's paving his streets with our standard of finances, the finest gold that there is. And he's paving his streets with it. Well, you know, we've got to be a good steward of God's money. When are we going to spend this money that God has access, given us access to? Not talking about being foolish, but we got to change the way we think about prosperity, change the way we think about finances. The way Elizabeth and I got started, when we got married, the Lord told me to go get a job at Pepsi. I mean, this is what's amazing about just learning to obey God. He spoke to me, I want you to go get a job at Pepsi. I pull into the parking lot, I walk up to the front office, and there's a big white sign with red letters that says, we are not accepting applications. I'm like, Lord, he said, just do what I told you to do. So I go in the front office, and I go in and I said, hey, I'm here to fill out an application. And the woman goes, okay. So she gives me an application. You know, the sign just said, we are not accepting applications. And she gives me the application, I fill it out, she hands it back out, and she goes, do you have time now for an interview? Well, let me check my schedule. Yeah, I think I'm clear. And so the guy comes out, the company controller comes out, their accountant comes out, he goes, Jim, you come back to my office. Here's my entire interview. He said, okay, when can you start? That was it. And so the Lord spoke to me when I got that job, when he gave me that job, he said, if you will honor me here, I'll honor you here. And I watched God promote me through that company. In 6 years, I became the youngest man they'd ever had in management. At 24 years old, I had a company car. I had men working for me. I mean, there's a whole lot of testimonies that God did while I was there. And then the Lord spoke to me and said, I want you to quit your job. And I'm like, Lord, why not back when I was cleaning toilets? I mean, that would have been easy to quit this job. Now I got a company car, I have full benefits, and now you, but I didn't question it. And so I turned in my resignation. I gave them, and my resignation, the first line says, as of April 16th, I resigned my position here at Pepsi. And then the rest of the resignation, a full page, was my testimony. And I told him, here, ever since I've gotten born again, all I've wanted to do was please God. It's what I'm doing now. But now the reason I went into all that, God didn't tell me quit your job and go into ministry. All he told me was quit my job. Now, we were married. I mean, we still are married. So far. And we're going to stay married. But, I mean, I was married. I had three small children, a 150-pound dog, and the Lord tells me, quit your job. And so, and he didn't say, quit your job and go to ministry. He didn't tell me, quit your job and do anything. He just said, quit your job. And so everybody would come and say, what are you going to do now? I have no idea. They thought I was crazy. My family thought I was crazy. My coworkers thought I was crazy. People at the church thought I was crazy. One woman cornered Elizabeth in the bathroom and said, you and Jim used to be such nice people. But that's all I've ever known. But my mentality that I had when I quit my job and stepped out in faith is now things are going to be tough. And all the things we're going to do without. You know what I'm talking about? Because ministry is a tough life. And well, I didn't know I was in ministry. All I knew is I was obeying God. And do you want to take a guess at what happened? We went through hell. We never missed a meal. My kids, God gave me a word for my kids, you will never miss a meal. My kids now are grown, they're adults, they have children of their own, and they still tell me, Dad, you said we'd never miss a meal. But I got that word from God, but we went through some tough times. Electricity being shut off, water being shut off, taking the water meter out of the ground, that's kind of embarrassing. No gas in the car, no food in the house, I've been there. But my mentality was, this is what it's going to be like now because, you know, we're truly serving God. The more you study in the Word of God, when you serve God, that's when the blessing comes. Well, this Christian life, this Christian walk is so tough. No, hell is tough.
Yes, it is.
This idea that it's so tough being a Christian, that's a lie from the pit of hell. We have the blessing of God on our lives. We have the presence of God in our lives. We have the Spirit of God living on the inside of us. How in the world could you say this life is tough? But we've been bombarded with that mentality. You know, it's tough to serve God. No, it isn't. Not serving God is what's difficult. Serving God brings the blessing of God into my life. And the blessing of the Lord makes me rich and adds no sorrow with it. We've got to change our thinking about it. Proverbs chapter 23, it says in verse number 7, as a man thinks within himself, so is it. Look, you have to understand, it is a constant, continual process of renewing your mind in every area. Now, what I'm dealing with tonight is in the area of finances, the area of prosperity. See, you're going to be whatever you think you are. Truth is, it doesn't matter what people think about you. It's what you think about you that matters. I am 100% totally delivered from people.
All right.
I do not care what people think.
That's a blessing.
It doesn't matter to me. I'm not preaching to try to make you happy. I'm not preaching to try to get you to like me. It'd be nice if you did, but I don't care if you don't. My identity as a pastor, I'm telling you, we fight it in the ministry. My identity is not in my church, in my ministry, in what people think of me. My identity is only in Jesus Christ and what He's done for me. And that is totally liberating.
Hey, hey.
I don't care what people think about me. I'm not trying to please you. I'm not trying to please people. All I want to do is please God. But understand something. Look, I'm the youngest of 7 kids. Now, do I have any other babies in the family here? What is the one thing the baby of the family wants? We want everything, that's true. But we want people to like us. That's the bottom line. We want everybody to like us. And so I was raised with that. I mean, I grew up with that mentality, and I had to be totally delivered from it. That's not what I'm after. But I had to change my thinking about it. My identity is not in how you react to me. My identity is not whether you like my preaching or not. I really don't care. When I get in the car, all that matters is my wife is happy and God's happy.
Amen.
Amen.
That's it. That's all that matters to me. I'm not trying to please. But as a man thinks within himself, so is he. Now, I brought this out this morning for those of you that ever go to Job chapter 3. Man, we got to constantly work at changing the way we think. One area that my wife is really working, and both of us are working on, we're getting it out of our vocabulary, the word cheap. Cheap. We don't mind getting a good deal. We don't mind saving money, but I'm not looking for the cheapest deal. That's a poverty mentality. I'm just looking. A lot of people won't buy it unless it's on sale. Don't get mad at me. But if the only time you buy something is if it's on sale, that is a poverty mentality. If the only time you buy something is...
Amen.
Can I deal with a little bit about poverty mentality? Because we don't change that thinking, we're never coming out of poverty.
Teach it.
And so you walk into a store, and where's the first place you go is to the clearance rack?
Yes.
That's a poverty mentality. You know, God can get you the money to buy the thing at any price. I got no problem getting a sale. I like walking into stores, and whatever we're looking at just got marked down. I'm not against that. I'm not preaching against that. But I'm talking about a mentality that the only time you're even interested is if I can get 75% off. Can I deal with one of the pastors fight? I was talking to a pastor just a couple weeks ago, and they have the building that they're in, and they're believing God for the building. And I said, "Pray." And they said, "Pastor, we want you to agree with us that God, you know, this is our building." I said, "I can agree with that." And they said, "What we're believing is that the owner of this building is going to give it to us." I said, "Why don't you believe God for the money to go pay for the building?" And it was like, isn't that funny? We think it's easier to believe God for a car than it is to believe God for the money to go buy a car.
Amen.
Got to change the way we think. Because then you're always looking for a way to get... I can believe God for the money and then go buy whatever I want. There's... But again... Job chapter 3, verse 25. After all this has happened to Job,
right,
he lost everything except his wife. And I think he got to the point he wished he had. But he says, "What I have greatly feared has come upon me." He offered sacrifices every day, all day, just in case his children sinned. You know, people ask us, you know, what did you do? Our kids were born again at an early age. They've never walked away from God. They've served God their entire life. How did you do that? We never expected it to be any different. Never expected our kids to get into sin. Now, look, we were involved in their lives. We were in their stuff. One of the things I had to change my thinking about is the things, as my kids, as teenagers, that would come and they would come and talk to me about. We have a very open relationship with our kids, and you know, my son's going, "Hey, Dad, this girl," and I'm like, "Well, why are you talking to me?" It felt so foreign to me. Another area that I had to change my thinking is I was judging my kids by my action when I was their age. And the Holy Spirit said, "They are not like you." Thank you, Jesus. They don't have the same motives you have. They don't have the same thought because we didn't raise them that way. And my expectation was not that they were going to do the things I did. My expectation was they're going to serve God. I had to totally work at changing the way that I thought. Now go to 3 John. I know you're familiar with this. I know 3 John verse number 2. I'm not trying to bring you something you've never heard. I'm just trying to get us to get to where we use what we know.
Yeah.
Most churches, you could hand out a quiz on prosperity or faith or healing, and they could pass the quiz. But how many of us are applying it in our lives every day and seeing the result of it? You don't need some great new revelation you've never heard before. You just need to start doing what you know to do. Because God cannot, will not bless what you know to do. How many times do we know what to do, but we just don't follow through and do it?
Amen.
3 John verse number 2. He says, "Beloved, I pray that in all respects you prosper in being in health, just as." Now that phrase, "just as," comes from the Greek word kata, which means here's the system of measurement God's going to use. Just as your soul. And that word soul in the Greek is the Greek word psuche, and it's talking about your mind, your will, and your emotions, your thinker, your chooser, and your feeler. God says, "I can't prosper you. You will not be in health any further than you change your thinking about those areas." Beloved, do you understand? You can be a tither, you can be a giver. You are not going to wake up one day shocked that you're rich. But most Christians live their life that way. Like it's going to, boom, just drop in their hands. And, "Well, I don't know where this came from." I can tell you everything my wife and I have now, I can tell you where it came from. And God keeps showing me things. Seed that we sowed 20 years ago that made absolutely no sense that we're seeing the result of now. I do remember years ago, we knew we needed to get seed in the ground. And we had no money. We didn't have, as far as I was concerned, we didn't have anything. And the Lord says, "You need to get seed in the ground." I said, "Lord, you said you'd give seed to the sower." The only nice thing we had at the time was a brand new stove. We had just purchased a stove, and the Lord said, that's your seed." Yes. When I buy my wife a gift, I hide it in the oven. My wife's an outstanding cook. Don't listen to what I remember. She's an amazing cook. Just kidding. My wife cooks. She and I cook together. But we gave that stuff to her. And it was funny because I called a woman up. Lord told us who to give it to. And I called. She's an older woman in our church, a widow. And I said, "Hey, Betty," I said, "Lord spoke to me. We want to sell our stove to you." I will never forget this phone conversation. Because she said, "What color is it?" I said, "It's almond." She said, "Does it have two big burners, two little burners?" I said, "Yes, ma'am, it does." She said, "That's my stove. Get it over here." The exact stove that she was believing for. Well, then, I guess it was 15 years later, we found some water damage in our kitchen. And so we knew we needed to get the repair work done. And I was doing an offering, and I brought this in about, and I just made the statement. I said, we're getting ready to remodel our kitchen. And after the service, one of the men in the church who owns a remodeling company came and says, "Let me know when you're ready to do your kitchen." And so a couple of weeks later, we got ready to do it. And I said, "You told me." He said, "Okay, we'll come over and we'll take a look at it." And he said, "You buy the supplies, I'll remodel your kitchen." When they were done with us, they told us that it was a $33,000 remodel that they sold to us. Now, since then, we have put all new appliances in it. All stainless steel, exactly what my wife wants. And everything paid for. That the Lord reminded me, that stove you sowed 20 years ago. Man, we got to change our thinking. We got it. God's not poor. God doesn't have any lack. But we have to change our thinking. We've got to change our thinking about this. Now go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. If we're going to walk in the level of prosperity, then we got to get it down on the inside of us and in our head that God has already made us rich. Amen. Do you understand this? I'm not trying to get saved. Amen. Right?
Right.
I've got someplace I'm going. I'm not trying to get saved. How many are born again? Amen. How many are trying to get saved? Isn't that funny? Because when you were born again, the fullness of the Godhead bodily came to live on the inside of you, and you were made as righteous as Jesus Christ. I'll never be more saved than I am right now. I'll never be more righteous than I am right now. Well, everything was completed at the cross. So if I was saved by the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, the same Jesus who became sin for me that I might be made the righteousness of God is the same one who took sickness on him, and by his stripes I was healed. I'm not trying to get healed, I am healed. And he became poor that me through his poverty will be made rich. See, I got to change my thinking. I'm not trying to get money, money's trying to get to me. I'm not trying to get rich, I already am rich. And when you get that, see, if you don't understand already being rich, you're always trying to find a way to get money. You're always trying to think, and pastors were terrible at it. Got to find a way to raise money. How do you raise money? I don't. Listen, be real quiet. Listen. You hear that? That's money trying to find Pastor Jim. I hear it. Where is it? We got to get to it. I've had people call me, and one guy called me, and he goes, "Where are you?" He was creepy. All I could think of was that State Farm commercial. What are you wearing? When I was sitting in my office at the church, and this guy calls me, and he goes, "Where are you?" I said, "I'm sitting in my office." "How long are you gonna be there?" I said, "You know, I'll be here in the afternoon. Stay there. I got to get this money to you." And drives to the office, walks in my office, lays down a check, takes off. We were in a hotel in Atlanta at a financial conference. This is funny. This is an area that we've worked to change our thinking. Have you ever gone to a conference and you have money outside that that's how much you're going to sow for the week? And so you have it divvied out so, you know, you don't miss an offering. You know, that way people can see you put in every offering. Don't look at me in that tone of voice. I know. And so we go down to this conference, a financial conference. We've got food money. We've got our seed money. And the first night of the conference, John Avanzini's there, and we gave it all away. Everything we had put in the offering. We got no food money. We got nothing. And in my mind, I'm thinking, now, when we get home, you know, where people know us, because nobody knows us here, I'll reap harvest on us. Now, I realize y'all don't ever think like that, but y'all pray for me. I'm coming out of this. And so I'm sitting in the lobby of the hotel waiting for Elizabeth and the other couple that's with us, thinking that. You know, when we get home, Lord, we did what you told us to do, and in my mind, I'm thinking, when we get home, we're going to reap harvest off this. And the Lord said, "I know where you are every minute of every day." And I got it. So I'm sitting on the couch and I said, "Lord, you know where I am every minute of every day, and I want harvest right now." A couple minutes later, this guy comes down the elevator, had no idea who he is, comes down the elevator, walks out of the lobby of the hotel and just stops. Looks up this way, walks back into the hotel, throws $150 in my lap, and walks back out of the hotel. I mean, it was like God, he was talking, God's talking to him. Like, okay, I'll go give it to him. So I get home, laying on my couch at home, and I said, "Lord, you know where I am every minute, every day, and I want harvest today." About 30 minutes later, I hear tires squeal in my driveway. A woman comes running up the sidewalk, opens my door, throws $100 in, shuts the door, gets in her car, and takes off. So my son's about 11 or 12 years old then. I heard me preach about it. He goes, "Dad, I got this." I said, "You got what?" He goes, "God knows where I am every minute of every day." This is Sunday morning. We're getting ready to go to church. And he said, "I told God this morning, you know where I am every minute of every day? And today I want a Mountain Dew." And so we get in the car and we're headed to church and I'm thinking, you know, bless his heart. I don't want him hurt. You know, I gotta help God out. So we stop at a gas station, I go in, I get a little 16-ounce bottle of Mountain Dew and I stick it in my pocket, and I'm thinking when I get to church, you know, because you gotta help God out. And when I get to church, I'll just have somebody bring it to him. We pull into the church parking lot, there's a woman waiting for us. And she goes, "Pastor Jim, I hope you don't mind. I'm just doing what God told me to do. But the Lord told me to get this for James." and walks over with a case of 2 liters of Mountain Dew. I took my little 16-ounce bottle and shoved it way underneath the seat. And the Lord said, "Seriously, 16 ounces?" Cheap? And I'm telling you what, beloved, it changed a mentality in me. I mean this, beloved, I'm not saying this, you know, we say it this way, I'm not saying this in faith, I know this.
All right.
You could take me and drop me on an abandoned island when you came back, I'd be rich.
All right, amen.
I don't have any question about it. I'm trying to figure out, God is amazing how he'll get money to us. He doesn't have any lack. He doesn't have any limit on how we can do it, except how we think he can. This is what Jesus said when he said, how can I explain the kingdom of God? He said, it's as if a man should cast seed into the ground, and he should sleep night and day, and the earth should bring forth fruit. He doesn't know how. The guy who sowed the seed doesn't know how. And here we're trying to figure out how he's going to do it. And look, we've all done it. We make sure. I remember back in the day bleeding for our electric bill to be paid. And I come to morning prayer, and I'm trying to scope out the one that may still have money. You know what I'm talking about? You think about it. And you want to get right next to him and say, "Lord, I thank you that my electric bill's paid. $187.92. Lord, you said a man would give unto my bosom $197, I don't know, $187.92. I've never had a need met that way. Never. And never, it would never come through who I thought it was. As a matter of fact, when I picked out who it was, that's exactly who it was not. We got to change our thinking. I remember in one church I was preaching, I don't remember now where we were, it was in another country, and I'm really working this into the people, and I said, beloved, you have to so change your thinking that you can say this out loud and it not feel funny. I'm rich. I'm rich. I'm rich. And so I'm in front of the congregation, I said, I want you to say this, I'm rich. And they all went, "You're rich." You have to get to the place that you can say. I remember walking around this dumpy little house that we were living in. The carpet was so worn, when you vacuumed it, it didn't change. There was no pile left. It was just, it was green backing. When it rained, the ceiling leaked, the basement flooded. If we didn't get out, we were drowning. It's the first time I've ever convinced my wife was trying to kill me. It rained so hard, our basement flooded. It was thigh deep. And the sump pump had come unplugged. So I'm going through the water, and I got the plug, and I'm getting ready to plug it back in. I think, this is not a good idea. That's wisdom. And my wife, who loves me, I think, says, "Get up on the dryer and plug it in." You know that big hunk of metal tied to 220? Yeah, get up on that. We had secondhand furniture. Everything we owned was second hand, third hand. Some didn't even have a hand. Got a couch, some legs broken off. You got bricks underneath it to try to... And we all have one of that. And I just want... And most of you have heard me tell this story, but I'm sitting there going, God, I am tired of being broke. And the Lord said, "What are we going to do about it?" I said, "Kind of hoping you'd do something." Kind of hoping you're just waiting for me to finally stand up and say, "I'm tired of me." And this is this is the part of that testimony I normally don't tell. Because the Lord said, what scriptures do you know about prosperity? I said, I know a bunch. Let me give you a piece of advice. When you're having a conversation with God, that's not the tone to use. And the Lord spoke to me. He said, sit down and write them all out. All the scriptures that you know on prosperity, sit down and write them out. Now I thought I had a bunch of them. I sat down and wrote out three. That's all I could think of. And the Lord said, that's your problem. And so I sat at my desk for 3 days. This is long before I had a computer, long before an iPad or anything like that, with my Strong's Concordance, my Bible, and a notebook, and wrote out 8 pages of prosperity scriptures. That's not all of them. That's just the ones that, and I'd get up every morning and I'd confess through those scriptures, and every day at lunch and every night before I went to bed, I'm walking around this dumpy house looking at my dumpy stuff saying wealth and riches are in my house. And it felt funny. I felt like I was lying. But I wasn't. I was going to the truth. Yes. The facts were we were broke. The truth is wealth and riches are in my house. Amen. And I began to work that word and work that word and work that word. And love it now, wealth and riches are in my house.
All right. Amen.
I can't see it any other way. I can't. I tried being broke and I didn't like it. Mm-hmm. I had to change now my mentality is anything short of wealth and riches is a breaking of God's promise, and I will not allow it.
Amen.
I don't know how to think poor anymore. I really don't. I was raised to think poor. When we got married, we thought poor. I don't know how to think poor anymore.
All right.
Elizabeth will come and she'll say, how do you want to get this? Get whatever you want. She can have whatever she wants. I want her to have whatever she wants. I don't know how to think lack. I don't know how to think doing without. I'm not talking about living outside your means. But you are never going to get outside the means you have now unless you change your thinking about this thing about money. Pastor, I'm afraid money will ruin me. Money doesn't ruin anybody. Money magnifies who they already are. Well, I know people, they got money and they divorced their wife. They wanted to divorce her all along. They couldn't afford to. They got money and they got off into sin. They always wanted to get into sin, but they couldn't afford to. Money doesn't change people. Money's just a magnifier of who they already are. You got to change your thinking about that. Well, I think I can serve God better poor. Okay? They probably flew y'all to Africa for free, didn't they? They charged you for it? Wow. Isn't that amazing? Why'd you go? Because the Lord said to go. Isn't that amazing? But you can serve God good broke, can't you? Not at all.
Not at all.
I mean, how many want to please God? That's all I want. And so, let me test you about what your mentality is about money. Y'all want to please God, right?
Amen.
Let's say, I'm not saying I am, but let's say that I am the voice of God right now. And I say, tomorrow, I want you in China. What's the first thought that goes through your head?
Oh,
man.
You need a passport.
But honestly, what's the first thought? Do you know how much a ticket cost the day before? Wait a minute, what happened to I want to please God?
You want to.
Well, God's got to give me a little more time. See, we come up with all the excuses why we can't do it. If God says, I want you in China tomorrow, guess what? The provision is there to get you to China. And can you imagine how easy it would be to please God if He says, I need you in China tomorrow, and all you have to do is call the airport and say, get my jet ready?
Amen.
See, y'all laughing. I'm totally serious. That's what I'm talking about. I'm not missing. Don't misunderstand, I'm not being critical of anybody. I'm talking about what I'm working on. When we go to Africa, we go to Angola, it is 34 hours of travel to get there. You know what that means? It's 34 hours of travel. Come on! That's 3 days of there's a level of wealth out there that most Christians don't even know about. I don't even know anything about that. Well, Pastor, I know you talk about cars and all that kind of stuff. Look, it's not about the cars. It's not about the stuff. But I said this earlier. I walked into church this morning to Pastor Bob's. How old is that young boy? 11. I walk in, and this 11-year-old boy, here's the guy here to preach. It's not about me. But I walk in, and he says, man, I like your watch. Man, I like that Bible case. Man, those are nice boots. And the next thing, I'm up behind the pulpit talking to him about Jesus. You understand, those young people have had the world, the sinners, to look at as success.
That's right.
That's the number one reason I want to walk in prosperity. I have a young boy in my church about the same age, and I rode my motorcycle to church one Tuesday night, and he told his mom, he goes, that's what I want to be like. I want to be a role model like that. But everything I have, the only thing I can tell you is how good God is.
Yes.
It's not how good my God is, it's how good my God is and how faithful He is. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I quoted this just a minute ago, verse number 21. He says, He made Him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. He became sin to make you righteous. Everything Jesus did at the cross was a substitutionary work. He did it so you wouldn't have to. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse number 9. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though He was rich, yet for your sake He became poor, so that you through His poverty might become rich. See, I don't have to be poor. You don't have to be poor. Just like Jesus took sin for you, He took poverty for you. But go to Philippians chapter 3. Let's go a little bit different. Go with me to Hebrews chapter 12. A lot of people had a problem with the prosperity message because Jesus was so poor. And our greatest desire is to be like Jesus, right? And so in the back of your mind, see, I was raised Catholic. And when you, if you're going to really serve God, you've got to take a vow of poverty and celibacy. So I got out of the Catholic Church. Pastor Callahan loved it. He laughs about it. Years ago, we took the spiritual giftings test that Peter Daniels did. And he just gets the biggest kick out of it. My two lowest scores. Now, I don't agree with Peter Daniels' belief on this, but he believes two of the spiritual giftings is poverty and celibacy, and those were my two lowest scores. And as a matter of fact, according to that gifting, I would rather be poor than celibate. He just gets the biggest kick out of it. He thinks it's hilarious. But I'm raised Catholic, and my mentality is, if you're going to truly serve God, you can't have anything. You've got to take a vow of poverty. So I'm working for 32 years to change that mentality, to get my understanding. But there's so much belief in the church world that Jesus was poor. Jesus was not poor. But look at this, Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 1. I'm going to show you scripture. You're not going to take my word for it. He says, therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us. Now, this is a deep revelation, but you really need to get a hold of it. Hebrews chapter 12 comes right after Hebrews chapter 11. I'm going to give you time to write that down because you don't want to forget it. I believe what he's talking about in the great cloud of witnesses is Hebrews chapter 11. Look at what they did. Look at what they accomplished. Let us also lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangled us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Now look at verse 2. Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter, the author and finisher of faith. And so if we don't understand what Jesus was really like, then every time we talk about prosperity and we think Jesus was poor, we've got this thing in the back of our mind saying, well, I can't be rich if Jesus was poor. Let's look at this. Go to Luke chapter 9. And let's take care of some of the scriptures that religion uses to tell us that Jesus was poor. Jesus didn't even have a house. Who do you think you are that you have a nice house and Jesus didn't even have a house? Well, chapter 9 is usually the scripture that people use. Verse number 57. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "The foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath nowhere to lay his head." See, Jesus didn't have a house. Well, go back to verse number 51. It says, when the days were approaching for his ascension, he was determined to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers ahead of him, and they went and entered a village of the Samaritans to make arrangements for him, but they did not receive him because he was going to Jerusalem. So now we've got to look at this in context. And it would be like, hey, I'm coming up to Morton to preach for Pastor Bob, and we call ahead and we say, you know, we're coming up this weekend, but then we're going up to Chicago. And you find out, you're going to Chicago. We don't want anything to do with you if you're going to Chicago. We don't want you here. And so if you would call me and say, "Pastor Jim, I want to go with you to Morton," I'd have to say, you know, you better think about what you're saying, because we don't have a place to stay. And that's exactly what's going on with Jesus. They're on their way through Samaria, going to Jerusalem, and because he's going to Jerusalem, he sends messengers ahead to make arrangements. They don't want him there because he's going to Jerusalem. And this young man comes and says, "I want to be a part of your ministry." And Jesus said, "You better think about it, because tonight, foxes have holes, the birds of the air have nests. We don't have a place to stay." But if you go to John chapter 1, see, I'm just working on our thinking. When I realized how wealthy Jesus was, it says in John chapter 1, verse 38, Jesus turned and saw them following and said to them, "What do you see? What are you looking for?" And they said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" The King James says, where dwellest thou?" In verse 39, Jesus said to them, "Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of..." Is that what yours says?
No.
He said, "Come and see." I thought he didn't have a house. And not only did he have a house, he had a nice house, because look at what happens. So they came and saw where he was staying, and they stayed with him. So not only did he have a home, but he had a home nice enough that people could come and stay with him. Let's look at a couple more. Go to Matthew chapter 2. Is this okay?
Yes.
Matthew chapter 2. In verse number 11, "And after coming into the house, they saw the child with Mary's mother." Now, I know we're word people. I know you know this. You know, we do our little Christmas nativity scene, and everybody's at the stable. You know, Jesus was born in a manger. When I read my Bible, it said Joseph went to the hotel, and there was no room in the inn. This is deep, but broke people don't go try to stay at a hotel. It wasn't the fact that they didn't have any money. They said, "There's no room here." So he had money to go stay. But understand something. The wise men weren't there. Why did they come to the manger? How many wise men came to visit Jesus? We don't know. We know how many different gifts they gave. But in that day, those magi traveled in bands of about 50. And so now it says when he was a child. Now we know he was probably about 2 years old, because after the Magi came, Herod gave the decree to kill all the children, 2 and under. So we know he's about 2 years old. But it says, they fell to the ground and worshipped him, then opening their treasures. See, we got this picture of this little play we do at church of three kids in their bathrobes and their cigar boxes. And that stupid little song, "Poor Little Drummer Boy." "I have no gift to bring, pa rum a pum pum." The only reason I know that is because when I was little, I paid the little drummer boy. It says they came and opened their treasures, and they presented to him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Now there's a businessman, a Christian businessman in Australia named Peter Daniels. Peter Daniels is one of the wealthiest men in the world. He's so wealthy, his company has its own currency. And he preached at Brother Copeland's conference probably about 10 years ago now. And he has a research team that all they do is research biblical truth for. And so he said, you know, these kings, they made such a huge uproar or these magi, I'm sorry, the wise men that came to worship Jesus, they made such an uproar. Remember, Herod was scared. And so Peter Daniels began to think about it and thought there must be some historical record of these men coming to visit Jesus. So he turned it over to his research team. And so the research team went down through historical records and found the records of this visit. Now, in the day they came to worship Jesus, the Roman army was off at war. Jerusalem, that's where Herod was, that's where he was occupying, was unguarded because his soldiers were off at war. History says this. This band of wise men that came to worship Jesus had hired 1,000 of the top archers of the day to guard their treasure. They were traveling in band of about 50 that came to worship Jesus. Now, can you imagine being king, or Herod, being over Jerusalem, your army's gone, and all of a sudden this entourage being guarded by 1,000 of the top soldiers of the day arrive at your city? It might make you a little nervous. And history tells us the wealth they brought to Jesus in that initial visit was $4.3 billion worth of wealth. I've got to get back on that meal plan. At 2 years old. Now, the interesting thing is there's no record anywhere of what happened to the wealth. But what I want you to see, Jesus was not poor. Some people say they lived off it when they went to Egypt. Remember, they fled to Egypt, and that may have been part of it, but you're not going to spend $4.3 billion staying for that amount of time. But that's how his life started. Let's look at a couple other things. Go to John chapter 12. I just want to change your thinking. When you see that Jesus is rich, and the Bible says, as he is, so am I in this world. Is there any account given to us in the New Testament of Jesus ever having lack? Jesus didn't know how to do lack. They said, we got to feed these 5,000 men, not including women and children, probably 15,000 to 20,000 people. They brought them a little boy's lunch, but once the not enough touched the more than enough, it became more than enough. That same God is on the inside of me. The same Spirit of God is on the inside of you. And if we can understand that prosperity, that wealth that's in us, when what's not enough touches us, it becomes more than enough. We can't stay in lack. John chapter 12. I'm sorry, I'll try to calm down. I hate poverty.
Amen.
Well, Pastor, you just don't know what it's like. Where my church is, 25 years ago, was declared the poorest county in the nation. There's a newspaper in London, England called The Guardian. You know the paper? They're doing a series right now on the poorest places in the world. And their first in the series was Beattyville, Kentucky, where our church is. A newspaper in England writes an article about Beattyville, Kentucky. CNN did a special a couple months ago about, listen to this, here's The Guardian doing an article about the poorest place to live in the world, and CNN did a news report on the new level of hope in Beattyville, Kentucky.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. Hallelujah.
Showing the world that we got people ready to work, that we've got factories that have closed down, and you know businesses are thinking, we got workers, we got facility, that's all I can see. What a God we serve.
Amen.
Advertising around the world, Beattyville, Kentucky. Who in the world? Have you ever heard of Beattyville?
Nope.
I'll tell you if you know Beattyville or not, what's our yearly festival? The Woolly Worm Festival. The Woolly Worm Festival. John chapter 12. Businesses are coming in. Beattyville, Kentucky has 1,100 people. 1,100 people. Auto just came in and opened a store. Built a brand, bought a lot, built a building, and there's already two car parts stores in the town. Why in the world would they do that? Because they know the blessing of God's here.
Amen.
Oh, were you trying to tell me you had something to do with that? Yes. Let's look at how rich Jesus was. How many poor people do you know that need an accountant? A full-time treasurer. Because didn't Jesus have one?
Yes.
He had a dishonest one. Now let me ask you. If you got 10 $1 bills and I come take three of them, are you going to notice? But here it is, John chapter 12, verse 6. Now, talk about Judas. Now, he said this not because he was concerned about the poor, but because he was a thief and had the money box, and he used to pilfer what was put in it. He stole out of the money box. And nobody but Jesus knew it. That's some money. I remember when the Lord began to really work on me. Most of us right now, don't answer this, don't even respond, but most of us right now, if I could ask you, you would know two, probably down to the penny, how much money you have on you right now. And so for the longest time, the Holy Spirit would not let me count the money in my pocket. And I'm like, well, look what, he goes, I have to get you to the place that you have more than enough. That you have so much wealth that you can't even count it. And if you keep track of everything, I'm just talking about in my pocket. I'm not talking about not the checking account. I'm not talking about, I'm talking about just what's in my pocket. And so my first thought was, Lord, if I don't know how much money I have, how do I know what I can buy? See, I'm still thinking lie. And the Lord said, if you'll listen to me, you'll always have enough.
Amen. Amen.
And so I went the longest time. You could ask me, how much money do I don't know. How much money is in your pocket? I don't know. God's trying to get us to the place that we're thinking more than enough. And we've got, I'm sorry, I woke you. Jesus had so much money in there. Most churches, we know exactly how much is in the account. And if somebody was stealing from us, we'd know it right away. Jesus got so much in the bag, nobody but him knows. It's amazing how we look at scriptures. Remember when I was talking about earlier about feeding the 5,000? And Philip came and said, or Jesus looked at Philip and said, where can we buy bread? I'm going to tell you what I believe about that area of scripture. I don't believe necessarily Jesus' original plan was to get the little boy's lunch. This is just Pastor Jim's opinion. I believe when he looked at Philip and said, where can we buy bread? That if Philip had said, there's a store over here that I know can produce it, by the time he got there, the money would have been there. Amen. See, we get this mentality that it's always got to be this financial miracle, and God never intended us to live from financial miracle to financial miracle. He wants us living in abundance.
Hallelujah.
We're not designed. Miracle to miracle is the wilderness. God said, I'm taking you in land that flows with milk and honey. You're going to live in houses you didn't build, eat from vineyards you didn't plant. You're going to have so much wealth. Don't forget that it was me that made you rich.
Amen.
So I believe when Jesus said, where can we buy bread? And Philip said, 200 penny worth isn't enough to feed just a few. Right away he blew it. Right into lack mentality. But even that 200 penny worth, that doesn't mean anything to us. I think the New American says 200 denarii. A penny worth of denarii is one day's wage. So 200 denarii, 200 penny worth is 200 days' wages. That's a year's salary. The average salary right now in the United States is $33,000 a year. So Philip said, "Do you want me to go into the bag and get $33,000 and go buy bread? Because that wouldn't be enough to feed everybody, to give everybody just a little." I believe he was on the right path, and Jesus never got out of faith. Philip, you were so close. And then Andrew comes and says, "We got a little boy's lunch." What good is that? Jesus said, "Bring it to me. Just bring it to me. I don't know lack. I don't know how to live in lack. I don't know how to operate lack." And so they brought him the little boy's lunch, and he feeds the 5,000. Not just enough. Because our God always does exceeding abundantly above what we could ask or even imagine. But we're sitting here believing him for just enough. Oh, I hear that. Pastor, I don't want to be rich. I don't need to be rich. I just, want to get my needs met. And that's become like this sanctified, "Oh, I'm holy. I only want enough for me." We got a world dying and going to hell, but your needs are okay? That's selfish. That's not sanctified. That's not holy. That's selfish. Go to Psalm 35. Am I helping you?
Yes.
Am I making you think?
Yes.
I don't know how to think. I don't know how to think poorly. I don't know how to think lack. Once you get a taste of it, there's a limit. I know I kid about it a lot, but look, we fly a lot. And flying business class is a whole lot better than flying economy. Just in case you wonder. I mean, your seat folds down into a bed. They bring you a down comforter. They bring an ice cream sundae cart around. An ice cream sundae cart. Oh my. And the first time we ever flew business class, my wife looked at me and she goes, "We're not flying in the back anymore." Because once you taste it, I'm not talking about the ice cream cart. But you know, I was on a flight. I don't think Elizabeth was with me on this flight. And it was a regional flight. It was just in the United States. And I was sitting in first class. And this family comes on. See, beloved, you got to be taught poverty. I want you to hear it. You have to be taught it. And so I'm sitting there, nice big seat. They come and say, "Sir, would you like something to drink before we take off?" And this family gets on. This little boy, probably 6 or 7 years old, jumps up in the seat next to me. He looks at me and goes, "These are nice." I mean, it don't take a genius to figure out this is nicer than back there.
Yeah.
And so his dad comes on. He goes, "Dad, I want to sit up here." This is what dad said to him. "Son, only rich people sit up here. We will never sit up here." I wanted to punch his dad. I was so angry. But he grabbed that kid. He goes, "We'll never sit up here. This is where rich people sit." Now it's embedded in that kid. Two things. We're always going to be poor. And it's never going to change. This is where rich people sit. That kid knew prosperity right away. His dad is better up here. I've watched people walk into stores, and I was walking into Lowe's one day, and they had this beautiful hot tub sitting right up front. And the little boy walks right up and goes, "Dad, we need one of those." He said it. "We'll never have anything like that." And the little kid's like, "Okay, I didn't realize." Man, we're And so many of us have had that kind of stuff bombarding our heads our entire life. My wife brought me out of poverty mentality. I didn't understand buying nice clothes. I didn't understand buying nice things. If you can get that, now I don't buy clothes secondhand, but and one of my favorite stories of Pastor Navidiville is we were in between buildings and I had to rent the Mason's Lodge. and they used it for other things when we didn't have service. And so one Sunday we show up for service and they're having a yard sale inside the Mason's Lodge. And we're standing there during praise and worship, and my kids, they're just little, they will not stop laughing. I'm getting mad at them. I'm correcting them. I'm angry. And finally my daughter goes, "Daddy, you look." And here I am, I'm a preacher of prosperity, and over here in the corner is a box that says bras and panties, 50 cents. I've been broke, but I ain't never been so broke I'm buying used underwear.
I remember going into nice stores,
constantly until I felt comfortable being there. I would go into nice clothing stores and try things on until I felt comfortable. But I'm telling you, when I bought that pant, something in me changed. Something in my mentality changed. Now, like I said, I've given it away. I've given 14 of them away. And I have a very nice collection. I have one pen that I bought it, I don't know, probably 12 years ago. And I went back into a pen store a couple months ago, and I was talking to the guy about it, and he said, I will buy that back from you for more than what you paid. God, there's a level of... John Evans carries a Montblanc pen that's $10,000. Somebody gave it to him. $10,000 pen. Well, I don't know. I think that's just silly. He ought to sell that and put that into the gospel. You have no idea how much that man has put into the gospel. You have no idea how much Elizabeth and I have put into the gospel. Let me give you just a couple of scriptures. And then I'm done. Not that I'm done. I just leave early in the morning. And I'm a little tired. I had to win a basketball game today for Kentucky, and I'm worn out. I got the win today.
We're glad you were there.
Hey, they better be. Psalm 35. I'm just going to give you a couple of the scriptures that I stand on. That I work constantly to change the way that I think. I don't know how to think poor. I don't know how to think lack anymore. I don't think, well, how are we going to do this? If God said do it, He's going to take care of it. First time the Lord told me to go to Angola, guy walked in and put a blank check on my desk. He said, that's for your trip to Africa. I said, I need a limit. He said, there's no limit. I just need a day to transfer the money. And then he said, by the way, my pastor does not fly economy. My pastor flies business class. Now, this is a man who 2.5 years before had no money. And now he's giving blank checks and saying, I just need to be able to transfer the money. This stuff works. But it works if you work it. He says in Psalm 35, verse 27, let them shout for joy and rejoice who favor my vindication. And let them say continually, let them say continually, let them say continually, the Lord be magnified who delights in the prosperity of his servant. Psalm 112, verses 1 through 3, praise the Lord, how blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who greatly delights in his commandments. His descendants will be mighty on the earth. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in his house. And his righteousness endures forever. Beloved, I walk around my house every day saying, wealth and riches are in my house. Wealth and riches are in my house. And when I first began to say it, I felt funny saying it. We were broke. We had broken down stuff. But wealth and riches are in my house. And if you get to the place that when you say it, you believe it, you're going to have whatever you say. Wealth and riches are in my house. Last verse, Psalm 34. Psalm 34, verse 9, O fear the Lord, you His saints, for to those who fear Him, there is no lack. Amen. Oh, wait, you got to put everything together. If I fear God, I'm going to obey Him. If I fear God, I'm going to worship Him. If I fear God, not that I'm afraid of Him, but I honor Him. And then look at the next verse, verse 10. The young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they who seek the Lord shall not be in want of any good thing.
Amen.
I thank God every day, all through the day. Father, I thank you. The young lions may lack and suffer hunger, but I seek you, and I'll not lack any good thing. And it's amazing how your thinking changes. All of a sudden, we're not lack-minded, we're abundant-minded. All of a sudden, it's not just enough, we're living in more than enough. Amen. Because He is the God that does exceeding, abundantly, above all we could ask or even imagine. Didn't He say it? He didn't say, I'm going to fill your cup. That's not where He stopped. He said, your cup runs over. When He told Peter, after he fished all night long, throw down the nets, the Bible, he knew exactly how many fish it would take to break the net, to sink the boats, but he can't help himself. He gave him a net-breaking, boat-sinking harvest. He knew exactly how much bread it would take to feed all those thousands of people, but he can't help himself. They took up 12 baskets of the leftovers.
Right.
He doesn't know how to do just enough unless we limit him to the just enough God. And he's not. We get so excited because, praise God, this trip was paid for. Praise God. We're going to Peru in April. Pastor Callahan and Debbie, Elizabeth and I. That trip, 1 week of ministry in Peru, cost us $10,000. We pay everything when we're there. The hotel, we buy our own food, we buy our own plane tickets. So last Sunday, Pastor Callahan gets up, just an impromptu thing Sunday morning. He says, hey, we're going to Peru. We're going to receive an offering this morning. Whatever you feel led to do, do it. So they take up the offering. And in the offering is an envelope that says, I will match whatever comes in for this offering. That morning, $5,600 came in. So I called the gentleman. I said, hey, we're excited. You gave us that envelope. Said, we'll match you. I said, we only need $4,400 more. You know what he said? He said, God didn't tell me to meet the budget. God told me to match whatever everybody else gave, and I will bring you the check for $5,600. Now, I'm not a math genius, but 56 plus 56 is more than 10,000.
Amen.
More than enough. Because that's it. I don't know how to think any other way. He does exceeding abundantly above all I could ask or even imagine. And I can imagine pretty big.
Amen.
Give yourself time just to imagine. Set aside time every day to imagine. Because if you don't see yourself living any different than you are today, I'll come back in a year, I'll come back in 10 years, I'll come back in 50 years, and you're still going to be in the same place you are now. If I can't see it, I can't have it. If I can see it, I've got it. Amen?
Amen.
I don't know about you, but I preach myself happy.
Amen.
And I was happy when I got here. Hallelujah. We do love you guys. We love coming here. We love what God is doing here. It is an honor to be a part of what God's doing here. Hallelujah. Pastor, thank you so much.